today we're going to be talking about vaccine pharmacotherapy. And this may be more of an update and kind of an overview. I don't know how much you go over vaccines in P2. Did I do anywhere with P2? So from P1 to, I guess, P3, this is where you're kind of getting information on vaccines and it's pharmacotherapy. So this is more probably like a review and update since your 4 or 5 class. So vaccines are considered one of the most successful public health interventions of the 20th century. Vaccinations are considered preventive medicine. When you think about all of the medications and things that we dispense, most of them are for either prophylaxis or for maintenance after an injury has already occurred, somebody already has a disease that they're trying to manage. But with vaccines, the thing to note is that they are preventive. So they're given before anything occurs, trying to stop it. So this is considered preventive medicine. Vaccines are among the most cost-effective clinical preventive service, because if we can prevent a disease from happening, then we don't have to try to treat that disease, right? So this is one of the focus of Healthy People 2013, is to look at preventing infectious disease and also increasing our vaccination rates. So what do vaccines do? Well, they prevent disease in people who receive them, those people who come in contact with them. So all of this kind of goes back to herd immunity. It controls a lot of the infectious diseases that used to be popular in our country. We don't see a lot of that anymore. Every once in a while, there may be an outbreak that we may see or hear about in a certain state or something like that. And a lot of that is just because we've become kind of complacent, because we don't see the outbreaks like we used to. So we become relaxed in our vaccination efforts and staying up to date with our immunizations, because nobody's getting sick like that anymore. So it's something that as pharmacists, we still have to make sure that we are advocates, reminding our patients of, you know, that it's time for their vaccinations. And we ourselves, we have to remember that even as adults, you know, we are still required to be up to date on our medications, our vaccinations as well. So you've heard this adage about herd immunity. So of course, everybody's not able to be vaccinated. Some of them, whether it's by choice because of religious beliefs, or just because of their state being immunocompromised, maybe they're not able to take it. But the more of us who are eligible and able to do it, then we continue to protect those around us, our communities as well. So vaccine preventable diseases. So we're gonna be talking about these vaccines. There are like 17 targeted vaccine preventable diseases that the U.S. look at treating. So chickenpox, so varicella, diphtheria, flu, influenza, hepatitis A and B, Haemophilus influenza type B, human papillomavirus or HPV, the measles, meningococcal, mumps, pneumococcal, polio, rotavirus, rubella of the German measles, shingles or herpes zoster, tetanus or lockjaw, whooping cough or pertussis. So these are 17 vaccine preventable diseases. There are a lot of other diseases out there, but these are 17 that the U.S. target, and most of these, as you know, are either childhood immunizations that a child has from birth up until they're able to go to school. So let's look at the types of vaccines. So vaccines in itself is a classification. So we're going to look at how we break that classification down into the different types. So yes, there are several different types and we're going to look at them. Each type is designed to teach the immune system how to fight off a disease. So when scientists are looking at creating these vaccines, they're looking at how will it respond to the immune system? Who needs this type of vaccination? And what technology are we going to use to produce it? So these are your different types of vaccines. Inactivated vaccines, live or attenuated. What does the word attenuated mean? See it? Attenuated means weakened. So it's a live virus, but it's weakened. The messenger RNA or mRNA vaccine, we heard that talked about a lot, but what disease state? mRNA.
COVID.
I bet picked up my backbone on. What was it? COVID. Right, thank you. So subunits, you hear about subunits, recombinants, polysaccharides, conjugate vaccines, your toxoids, and your viral vector vaccines. So all of these are your different types and methods by which vaccines are created. So with inactivated, this is the killed version of the germ that causes the disease. It usually doesn't provide immunity that's as good as your live vaccine. It does not replicate, and therefore it does not cause the disease. The thing to note also, with a lot of the vaccines that you see, a lot of them do require boosters. So if I asked you to identify some inactivated vaccines, what would you tell me?
Requires booster.
Okay, that's a test question. Hepatitis A, flu, polio, rabies. These are examples of your inactivated vaccine. Your live or attenuated, remember we said attenuated means that it's weakened. It's a weakened form of the germ that causes the disease. So with your live, these actually are similar to a natural infection of you actually getting it and surviving it. So these are how these vaccines work. They have to replicate. That means that they're mimicking the actual infection that's occurring. The thing about it, they do create lifelong protection, but the thing about live vaccines is that everybody cannot have them if they are in an immunocompromised state, if you are pregnant, because there's no way for you to stop that replication from occurring. And live vaccines have to replicate in order to work, okay, in order to give you that protection that it needs. So you just one or two doses, most live vaccines can give you that life protection. A lot of these you don't see where you have to have a booster with your live attenuated vaccines. Some of the things just to know that they don't travel well because they have to be kept cool. So like in undeveloped countries that don't have refrigeration, this would not be a good product to try to transport. So if I ask you, give me an example of some live vaccines, what are you going to tell me?
MMR, rotavirus, smallpox.
Okay, live attenuated. And what does attenuated mean?
Weakened.
And what type of protection do they provide?
Lifelong. Okay.
Your messenger RNA or mRNA, they make proteins in order to trigger an immune response. The benefit of them is that they require shorter manufacturing time, they don't contain a live virus, and there's no risk of getting the virus because it's not being created using a live virus. You know, this was some of the, I guess, the pushback or the questions that people had when COVID came out was how are they able to produce it so soon? And it was because of this technology. So it required a shorter manufacturing time. A lot of people didn't know that it's not new technology. It's always been in existence. They pulled it out and just used it to help produce something that we needed immediately for the pandemic that we were facing. And again, it was the technology that was used for COVID-19. Which manufacturers use this technology?
Pfizer.
Pfizer? And Moderna. Very good. So this is, all of these are different types of methods that we can use. Subunits, recombinant, polysaccharides, and so forth. All of these are being used. They only use specific parts of the germ in order to produce the vaccine. Just about anybody can use these. There are little to no restrictions on who can use them, even people that have immunocompromised systems. But one of the limitations would be they do require boosters. So just to kind of break those down a little bit more, your polysaccharides. So these are short-lived immunity. There's no booster effect, so they require a booster. And they're not very well or often used in children just because they don't give enough immunity. So they're typically not seen in infants and young children. However, the conjugated version is. So it produces more of a memory. It results in a booster effect. And this is where you'd be seeing using a conjugate polysaccharide. What is a polysaccharide?
Sugar.
It's a sugar. So this is where you would see it in your younger children and even in some adults. So your inactivated vaccines are also available as polysaccharides. So if you looked at the chart that I sent you, you may be able to kind of decipher that. And then of course there's the recombinant, which is just a gene segment of a protein from the organism. They insert it into another cell to be able to replicate and obtain the vaccine that they are trying to manufacture. Okay, this is just a continuation. So if I asked you to identify some of these vaccines and to break them down into their subparts, what would you tell me about HIV? So you need to write this. It's probably not on your slide. Your Haemophilus influenza is a polysaccharide. Hepatitis B is a polysaccharide. HPV is recombinant. Whooping cough or DTaP is an inactivated, killed. Your pneumococcal and meningococcal were both conjugated. Shingles is live, attenuated. And this is shingles, let me make a notation here. This is shingles Zostavax that is no longer marketed in the US. So if I ask you about shingles Shingrix, it is recombinant. Are you familiar with Novavax? Have y'all heard of that? So this is another COVID-19 manufacturer, and it uses subunits. Say up here, subunits is protein subunit vaccine. So how many COVID-19 manufacturers do we have now? We have three. What three are you? Name them.
Novavax.
Say it again.
Novavax is one. New York.
Novavax is one.
Moderna and Pfizer.
Moderna and Pfizer.
Johnson.
Are they still out there?
It still exists. It's still a manufacturer of COVID-19. So we have four now. So then we have the toxoid vaccines, and they too, it produces a toxin and is made by the germ. The toxin comes from the virus, of course, itself, and it creates immunity. Again, remember what I said about they're taking pieces and they're targeting certain aspects of it. So this is what they're also doing with your toxoids. is, you need a booster. And a lot of you should be familiar with tetanus, because that is something that requires a booster every 10 years. So as adults, you should be getting your tetanus updated every 10 years. So if I ask you about toxoid vaccines, I would expect to hear diphtheria and tetanus. Your viral vectors, where have y'all heard this before? Where have y'all heard viral vector? Okay, it's part of COVID-19, and which manufacturer uses this technology? J&J. This is the technology that they use. The viral vector, Janssen's method. That too is something that's old. It's not new. They've used this as part of the Ebola outbreak. There are studies also with Zika, flu, and HIV. So it has been around. Different viruses that they use as vector would be flu, or influenza, VSV, measles, and even the adenovirus that causes the common cold. So if I ask you for an example of a viral vector, what you tell me? If I ask you for an example of a viral vector vaccine, what are you going to tell me?
COVID-19.
You're going to tell me it's COVID-19. And if I ask you who the manufacturer is, you're going to tell me who?
J&J.
So we're always looking at producing new things. So they're working on new types of vaccines, DNA, and also a recombinant vector vaccine. So this is something that's ongoing. So on this slide here, I just tried to break this down to kind of give you an example of the different viruses or the vaccines and the types of vaccines where they fall. If you look at live attenuated, and we said attenuated means weakened, you see MicroVY. That's supposed to be an acronym to try to help you to recall what your live attenuated vaccines are. So the M, of course, would be your MMR, measles, mumps, and rubella. I would be influenza. Keep in mind that influenza can be spread across and made differently through a lot of these different types. Okay, so you have to be aware that if I'm saying RAIV, meaning that that's a recombinant, that R stands for recombinant, you need to know that, or RAIV means that it's what? Inactivated influenza vaccine. So all of these little initials that you see are acronyms for what the vaccines are. So make sure that you know that, okay? So this LAIV, meaning live attenuated influenza vaccine 4, that 4 meaning that it had this quadrivalent, 4 things that's in it, and flu mist is a nasal spray. Then you have cholera, your rotavirus, your oral typhoid, varicella, chickenpox. Know the names of these, Varivax, your yellow fever, polio. Your oral polio vaccine is used in other countries. We actually have an injection in the States. We don't use the oral method anymore. Does anybody know how it was given orally by any chance? Nope. Actually, they used a cube of sugar. And they would put it in the cube of sugar, and then the child would just eat the cube of sugar back in the day. That's how they did it. So now it's an injection. The zoster shingles here, the zoster bags is no longer available or marketed in the U.S. as of November of 2020. Now this, again, it was a live attenuated vaccine. It's not marketed here any longer because they found that First of all, Shingrix is, was better at it. I think it had like a 92 to 40 something response rate in it. And also, what do we say about a lot of virus?
It's weakened.
Hmm?
It's weakened.
Okay. Yes. It does have to replicate for work, in order to work. But what else did we say about it? Who cannot take it? If you're immunocompromised, a lot of in pregnancy, it can't be used. However, with your Shingrix, it is a recombinant, so your immunocompromised people can take it. You're pregnant, can be taken during pregnancy. So, you know, it had a lot of benefits over the Zostavax as well. Okay. So when we're looking at the inactivated or killed, excuse me, when we're looking at inactivated or killed, you have polio or IPO, that's the brand name, hepatitis A, Havrick, or Bactol, diphtheria, tetanus, pertussis. What does the AP stand for in VTEF? What does the AP stand for? Anybody know what the A is? Well, you see that it stands for acellular pertussis. So you have diphtheria, tetanus, and acellular pertussis. Usually when you see pertussis, you see that little A, and it stands for acellular. Rabies is inactivated, Imovac, Ravivert, and then again, like I told you about your influenza, influenza vaccines can also be inactivated, so, and they're still quadrivalent. So all of your flu vaccines for this season are quadrivalent. They used to make some that were trivalent, but all of them now will have four components to them. Okay, so you see them as quadrivalent. Fluad, you see the ADJ, meaning it's an adjuvant that's in it, and we'll talk about that. Flucelvax, you see that it's egg-free. So people that have egg allergies know that there's something for everybody. Okay. Your polysaccharides are your hepatitis B. You see their names, injury B, recombat HB, your Haemophilus influenza or HIV, pertussis, the part of DTaP combined in the that schedule is considered to be a polysaccharide, that AP in it. Pneumococcal or the Pneumovax, and they're more with the pneumococcal. So we have what, 20, 13, 15, 20. So we'll talk about those later. Your pneumococcal 13 is considered conjugate, as well as your meningococcal. You'll see meningococcal ACWY. These are subgroups that they have targeted when creating the vaccine. Your recombinant is your Gardasil or HPV. Then your RIV4 quadrivalent egg-free flu block, which is a flu vaccine. And if you look at the brand names of all of your flu vaccines, if you notice, all of them have flu in them. Fluorid, Fluvac, Fluod, Flucelvax. And we already talked about Shingrix, which is a recombinant Zoster vaccine. Your meningococcal, the serial B, you'll see it as MenB, and sometimes it'll target some other things in it, like you see the MenB4C, the MenB-FHBP. These are all subgroups that they have added or they're targeting when they're creating the vaccine. Your toxoids are a again, diphtheria, tetanus. Your mRNA that we talked about, where your Pfizer and Moderna manufactured COVID-19. Just in here, I just put it for reference, Johnson & Johnson, J&J or Janssen uses viral vector. Your Novavax is a subunit, a protein subunit. I just put those in there for reference. So please refer to this chart. Adjuvants. When we're talking about creating vaccines, you know, a lot of different things go into it. People always want to know, well, what's in the vaccine, blah, 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 blah. And, but one of the things that I want you to know is that when you see ADJ or you hear about an adjuvant, that means that something has been added, an ingredient has been added to the vaccine to try to enhance its, that immune response, trying to make it stronger. So they add these different types of ingredients into them. I won't ask you about any of these, but I just think that this is something that you should know when you're talking about vaccine products, and people are asking about different things in it, whether it be preservatives or whatever. So you would know that these are being added only to create a stronger immune response to an antigen. And even your COVID-19 vaccines had an adjuvant to it. Why? Because it wanted to create a stronger immune response. We were in a pandemic condition, and we needed something that was not only being able to be manufactured quickly, but we also need to make sure that it created a stronger immune response. So looking at some of the vaccines a little bit closer, as I mentioned to you, please pay attention to the acronym, the LAIV, live attenuated influenza virus. So flu mist is the only nasal spray that we have that's that's LAIV, and it's for healthy people 2 to 49 years. It's a live vaccine, so we can't use it in pregnancy. So any other vaccine that's out there for flu can be used in pregnancy, and it can be used with without regard to breastfeeding as well. So for people that have egg allergies, as I mentioned, Flucelvax is egg-free. In our adults, 65 and over, we want to use a high dose. This Fluzone HD, HD stands for high dose. Fluad, again, has that adjuvant in it, and it's approved for 65 years and over. I mentioned that for this flu season, all components in the vaccine are quadrivalent. We also have a recombinant flu block that's also egg-free, and it's approved for 18 years and over. Everyone 6 months of age and older is recommended by CDC and also ACIP that they get a seasonal flu vaccine. So everybody, so you can get a flu vaccine starting at the age of what?
6 months.
6 months. It takes about 2 weeks for protection to develop against vaccines. And most of us have heard that, you know, I got the flu shot and it gave me the flu. But it does not cause the flu. Influenza vaccines do not cause the flu. So what do you think has happened? That individual who tells you, I got the flu shot and it gave me the flu. What would your response be?
They got the flu before the 2 weeks.
There are multiple.
Who's talking? I need one person to tell me. Tell the class.
There's multiple viruses out there.
Okay.
So, I mean, the goal is that, you know, it's going to try and take care of some of the others, but that's not going to be the case when they keep replicating every year. So it may only catch a certain percentage of it.
Right, very good. That is one of the reasons. It is, we have a lot of circulating strands that are out there. So just like for this year, whatever was happening last year, they captured those things, they produced the vaccine that we're using. But the flu is constantly prevalent, replicating throughout. So the actual vaccine that we probably took, number one, does not have every strand that's in it. So that person could very well have been exposed to a strand that was not in the shot, and therefore they received the flu. What's the other reason?
They got the flu before the 2 weeks.
Very good. It takes 2 weeks. So they could have already caught the flu during the time frame that immunity had not kicked in yet. So that's the other reason and stuff too. So when you're counseling your patients, you know, just kind of educate them on how the vaccine works, and so they'll be more inclined to go ahead and get their flu shot. So we mentioned all patients age 6 months or older, unless there's some type of contraindication. Any vaccine can be used within the FDA indication, as I mentioned. ACIP does not give a preference to any type. It's just based upon a person's contraindication, not as to what they, you know, which one they take. I already told you, if you look at the brand names, flu is in it. Pregnant patients, they can receive any age-appropriate inactivated influenza vaccine. You want to make sure that they stay away from any live vaccine. So do not administer the live influenza vaccine, and it's only available as what?
Flu mist.
As a nasal spray, all flu mist. Okay. For 65 years and older, the Fluzone HD or the Fluad, excuse me, that has the adjuvant, those are the ones that are indicated or recommended for 65 years and older. This is your DTaP, diphtheria, tetanus, and that acellular pertussis. So just note for DTaP is Infrared and Bactisil. If you look at the others, you will notice that they are additional, have additional components in it. What is IPV? What does IPV stand for? The I stands for what? Getting all of this, the diphtheria, tetanus, and pertussis, they are also getting their polio in Kineret or Quadricel. Here, the DTaP, they can get hepatitis B and the polio, is Pediatrix. They can get polio plus the HIV, Haemophilus influenza type B, which is Pentacel, polio, HIP, and then the hepatitis B, as that sells, all of this in one. There are about 26 or 27 vaccines that a child will have from birth up until the age of 2 that they are required to have. So just think that if we had to give them a shot 26 to 27 times, and this is times whatever the length of the series is. So by having combination reduces, of course, you know, how many shots that they would have to have individually. So this just gives you, I want to ask you about the series. Like this is said, children get 5 doses at ages 2, 4, 6, 12, 18 months, or 4 years, so on. I'm not looking at asking you that. But I will be looking to know what is DTaP and what are some of the So this is diphtheria and tetanus. So as you see here, even babies and children younger than 7 can get this. The note, and older children can get Tdap or TD. So a little thing to kind of remember here with regards to who can get which product. If you notice the big D, then that's for your younger children. So kind of think about the D and the alphabet comes before T. And so the T is for older children and adults. So if you're younger children, babies and your younger children are going to get the big D tap, and then your older and adults will get T dap. And tetanus, diphtheria, and all of these now, you need to make sure that you know their vaccine type. Okay, so we had that chart, kind of talked about it, so you need to know that chart. And I've been telling you this about tetanus, that it requires a booster, and we need to have this booster every 10 years. Okay, now if there are severe dirty wounds, burns, things of that nature, that it's required that you have it within 5 years. So this is something that will be given tetanus to someone, your burn victims and things, trying to curtail the tetanus virus from, because it likes wounds. That's where it likes to manifest and grow. Okay, this is your big T, tetanus, diphtheria, and acellular pertussis. So these are doses for 7 years and older. And it just kind of tells you single dose 11 to 12. Your pregnant women telling you how they should be given it, preferably during the early part of the third trimester. Adults who have never received Tdap should get a dose of Tdap. And I mentioned to you just now, 10 years or 5 years if there is a burn or some type of a wound. Okay. Hepatitis A, Havrick, Vactop, adult indications, MSM, IV drug abusers, and anyone else who wants it, even though there are specific indications, if it's warranted, then you just tell your doctor that you would like to have hepatitis A. Hepatitis B is the first vaccine that a child has after birth or at birth. It's given within 24 hours of the birth. So this is the first vaccine that's administered to a child at birth. It's your hepatitis B vaccine. Two doses, 0-1 month. Do not use in pregnant women. Gives you what the indications are for the thing that I want you to know. Hepatitis B is given beginning within 24 hours after a child's birth. Hepatitis A and B is a combo of, and it's called Twinrix. You can get both your hepatitis A and B in one shot, and it's called Twinrix. This too is followed by a booster, which dose at 12 months. Your HIV or Haemophilus influenza type B, your products or vaccine for HIV, Hibrix, Hibvaxib, and then it also comes in those combinations that we had talked about earlier. So you heard about varicella. Varicella-containing vaccines. These are live attenuated vaccines that we talked about before. Chickenpox or Varivax. Do not use in pregnancy or if a person is immunocompromised. It's a live vaccine and it's not used in pregnancy. You need to remember that when you are recommending products, and also if you are your patients or of a pregnancy category, the potential of, then you want to make sure that that you know that. So zoster, what is this related to? Urban zoster.
Shingles.
Related to what?
Shingles.
It is, but where else do we see this particular virus? Say it again. And chicken pox. Exactly. Chicken pox, there are several things to do that. Then when we see it in your older populations as shingles, then we call it zoster. So this is a recombinant, as I mentioned to you before, it's non-live vaccine. It's for ages 50 years and older. You should know this. You should get shingles even if in the past you had shingles. So if a person said, well, I already had it, I don't need to go ahead and get it. Nope, you need to still get the vaccine. I told you about Zostavax, that's no longer available. So if a person had Zostavax, it is recommended that they be revaccinated using Shingrix. Remember I told you that it was more effective than the Zostavax was, and so it is recommended that they have it. So if they had a shingles a history, they should still have it. If they had Zostavax before, they should have it. If they're not sure, if they had chicken pox, they should have it. So there's no maximum age for getting Shingrix, but it should start at least at age 50. Then we have HPV, or your human papillomavirus, and you may see this written as 9VHP, meaning 9-valent HPV, meaning that there are 9 components in this, this vaccine. Recommended age 11 to 12. They may start at age 9 if there is a history of sexual abuse. They can get the drug earlier. It is FDA approved for up to age 45. You know, most times we think of just your younger people up to 26, but even older. If you're older, you can even get this, but it's based upon your doctor, shared clinical decision making as to whether or not you really need to have it. Okay. And it is has yeast, so if a person has a yeast allergy, that is a contraindication. In our MMR containing vaccines, measles, mumps, and rubella. What's another name for rubella? Yes, German measles. So we see with this one here, adults over the age of 18 years, born up in 1957 with no evidence of immunity, that they should have it. Anybody prior to 1957, they feel that they already have immunity, therefore they wouldn't have to take this. So this is 2 doses given at age 12 to 15 months and age 4 to 6 years. And if you see that there is a 28-day, administration date in between them. So non-pregnant women of childbearing age with no evidence of immunity to rubella, this is you can have it. Of course, your international travel, do not use in pregnancy or immunocompromised. This says non-pregnant women of childbearing age, so don't get that confused. Non-pregnant women of childbearing age, do not use in pregnancy or if they're immunocompromised. As I mentioned before, those born before 1957, they're considered to be immune to measles and mumps. Therefore, they wouldn't have to take it. This is your meningococcal vaccine that with men, ACWY, men, C4. Remember, I was telling you about the serotypes that's in it. So that's all that stands for. Just know if I ask about, give me examples of these types of meningococcal vaccines, their brand names, what they are, and if I should ask you, what does ACWY? These also require boosters. This is just more of your meningococcal vaccine, Vitamin B, that we talked about. This just shows you that there's an adjuvant in it. Note with these is that the vaccines are not interchangeable. You must use the same product for all doses. So you can't switch and say, well, they came in for Bexero and then they came back in for the other dose and you want to give them tremendous. I already tell you they're not interchangeable, so you can't do that. Your pneumococcal vaccines. So you see that there's a 13, a 15, and a 20 valence. They're all conjugates. Pneumococcal, the conjugate vaccines, 13, 15, and 20. Note the name. Prevnar 13, the PCV 15 is Vaxneuvance, PCV 20 is Prevnar 20. In the series, one thing to know is, like with your 6 to 18 year olds, you can give either 13 or 15. You're not giving like 13 and 15 and so forth. You're either giving the 13 or 15 and the 20, and then we'll look at the polysaccharide one that goes along with this PESB 23. So you can administer either 13 or 15, excuse me, before giving any recommended doses of the 23, give one dose of 23 at least 8 weeks after they've either had 13 or 15, and you give the second dose of the 23 5 years after the first dose. So they get this, they wait 5 years before they get their second dose of PESB 23. So it's one or the other. They're not getting both of these. It's either 13 or the 15. This is a continuation, looking at the different ages. Adults 19 to 64. PCV 20 is used. A dose of PESV 23 is not indicated. Give one dose of 15 or the 20. If you use the 20, for that first dose, then you only don't have to use the PESV 23, and that's the same thing that kind of follows with your 65 year olds as well. So just note this, as I mentioned, the 13, 15, and 20 conjugated vaccines. Know their names. Also note here that PCV 13 and the 15, they can be used interchangeably. So it doesn't matter, you need one or the other. If both the 13 and your 23 are administered, your 13 or 15 is given first, and just remember, your earlier doses, 13 and 15 come before 23, when you look at your number line, right? So you're giving the lower numbers first before you're giving basically the higher number, that PESB 23. Your 15 or 20 dose should be administered at least 1 year after the most recent PESB 23 vaccines. Okay. Some people may have received the 23 first for some reason, so they would have to wait a year and they would receive either the 15 or the 20 should be administered later. For some reason, they got out of sequence and maybe the provider thought that they had already had and then found out later that they didn't. So anyway, they can go back and pick it up. So this is the eye pole. And that's the brand name. I think we already went over these names when we talked about DTAP. So as you see that they are also mixed with the polio. Rotavirus, I think that we tend to hear a lot about this in the newspaper because it affects infants. So RB1 or RB5 Rotatec given to all infants. And the first dose is either vaccine should be given before a child is 15 weeks, because they found that there are no studies to show that it's effective. They should begin it early, but if they wait until like 15 weeks, they feel like it's not effective at that point. They should have started it at the beginning because it has to be completed within an 8-month period. That the children should receive all of the doses of the rotavirus before they turn 8 months of age. And they tell you do not initiate a series on or after 15 weeks because they do not, studies have not shown it to be effective at that point. Okay. So the Rotarix is given two doses at age 2 to 4 months. Rotatec, 3 doses at age 2, 4, and 6. So the key thing here is the rotavirus, the names, and when it should be given and when it couldn't be given, okay? A review of our COVID-19, as we mentioned before, there are 4 manufacturers, your Pfizer, BioNTech. They use mRNA, so does Moderna. Janssen or J&J use that viral vector we talked about. Novavax, they use a subunit vaccine, a protein subunit. We probably haven't heard, have you guys used this, any of you that's practicing and doing immunizations, have y'all used this, Novavax?
No.
So it's a 2-dose primary series, age 12 and older. They are not authorized as a booster, so they would have to use Pfizer or Moderna if they had, they used that one. And there's still that recommendation with that primary series for everyone age 6 months and older, and the boosters for everyone age 5 years and older if they're eligible. So a lot of the big talk now is about those boosters, those bivalent boosters that's available now that has Omicron, you heard the BA4 and the BA5. So they're available now as of September the 2nd for people 12 years of age and older, and for people age 5 to 11, it became available October 12th. So those are some updates on COVID. So if I was asking you something, it would be here about technology. How was the COVID-19 vaccine? Is that mRNA? That's what I will be looking for. And I don't know how many of you have heard of this new medication. It's called Evusheld. Have y'all heard of this? So this is a medicine that helps to, it's a pre-exposure. So the person cannot have had COVID or be around someone that they normally knew had COVID in order to get it. So it uses, it's still EUA under the emergency use authorization. It's not FDA approved yet. It's approved for EUA. It has two different monoclonal antibodies in it. TIX-H they have, can't say this, Silgavimab. And as I said, it's pre-exposure. So it's used in adults or adolescents if you age 12 years and older, and there's a weight requirement. You have to weigh at least 88 pounds in order to have it. Not currently infected, have not recently had close contact with somebody, and are moderately or severely immunocompromised. And because you can't produce an immune response, then they think that this would be an option. Or if you had an allergic reaction to any of the other vaccines. So this has to be given in a provider's office, and you have to wait at least an hour for them to monitor you. So you would have, they would give you one shot of the antibody and then give you the other shot immediately after that. And then you would have to wait one hour for them to evaluate you. Typically, how long does a patient have to wait?
15 minutes.
Okay, 15 minutes. And this is manufactured by AstraZeneca. So just some other things that you should know, and let's just take a closer look when we're talking about pregnancy and vaccines. So they, before pregnancy, they can of course get the MMR. We talked about non-pregnant women get 1 month or more before pregnant, unless you're already protected. During pregnancy, you can have the Tdap vaccine to help protect against whooping cough. And how is whooping cough spread? This is pertussis. How does pertussis spread?
Through splatter, cough. Droplets.
Where do they get it from?
From
parents. They get it from adults, parents, caregivers. We're the ones that give it to them. So this is another vaccine that you need to make sure, especially if you're working around or you have babies and things that you're coming in contact with, because we're the ones that spread this to them, okay? The third trimester of each pregnancy between 27 and 36 weeks, so it's telling you when they can have the Tdap. They've never been vaccinated. If the woman has delivered and has not been vaccinated, it can be given post-delivery. Remember, because it's all about protecting that baby, so we want to make sure that that's on board. The flu vaccine, if pregnant during flu season, and it just tells you the date by the end of October if you are pregnant, because I think flu season starts like in September. So September, October are I guess our peak months. So we want to try to have it during that time. The nasal spray is not recommended. Why?
It's live.
So after pregnancy, it's safe to receive vaccines after giving birth, even while you are breastfeeding. Okay. COVID-19 vaccine is also recommended for pregnant people. So what about egg allergies and vaccine? Most people, a lot of controversy that people say that they are allergic to eggs and therefore they cannot take or receive a lot of the vaccine. Well, as you see, there are a lot of egg-free vaccines that are now manufactured, and they are saying also if it's of a severe allergy that you still can be vaccinated. It just has to be done within your provider's office to where they can monitor you. If it's really that bad, you can still take it, have it done, and your provider's office, and they'll just monitor you and provide any assistance, you know, if you require, if it's that severe. Okay? That's why I said under the supervision of a healthcare practitioner. So you see the types of products. Flublok is egg-free, approved for age 18 years and older. The Flucelvac is also egg-free, and it's for age 6 months and older. So, like I said, we got something for everybody. The nasal spray, again, is approved for use in healthy, non-pregnant people from age 2 through 49 years of age. Okay. Do not administer the live influenza vaccine, which is FluMist, if a person has a history of a severe allergic reaction to any ingredient. Children less than 2 years of age to the four that has asthma or a history of wheezing in the past 12 months, in a year's time frame. Children 2 to 17 that's on aspirin or salicylate type therapy, age 50 years and older, we're age 50 years and older are not to have this. And again, pregnant people and other medical conditions, if they're immunocompromised, then they cannot have this. Autism and vaccine. So we hear people talk about it again. I don't want it because, you know, it has preservatives in it and it's linked to autism, and so they don't want it. So a lot of the controversy was around Tamiflu, which is a mercury-based preservative, but it's not the same mercury that was found or used in fish. You know, I think it was like the mercury that was in fish or something that people were coming in contact with that was poisonous. So it's not that type of mercury. So they did years of testing. Different people have did different studies and stuff on the use of Tamiflu in autism, and have found that there is no link to it. So what do you tell your patients that are saying they don't want it? Well, you can tell them that there are preservative-free products that they can use. Your MMR, your varicella, polio, pneumococcal, they never had it in it anyway. It was never manufactured with the preservative in it. The preservative was used because the bottles, you know how you have the larger bottles, and it was to preserve that so that you could have multiple doses in that larger bottle. So now, you know, one of the other things they have gone to make like single-use vials instead of those big vials that for multiple use. So to try to help curtail that as well. But that's why the preservatives were being used. It's because of those bigger bottles that was being used at the time. All vaccines routinely recommended for children 6 years of age and younger in the U.S. are available in formulations that do not contain Tamiflu. Vaccines that do not contain it as a preservative are also available for adolescents and adults. The use of Tamiflu as a preservative in vaccine has declined due to reformulation. Like I was saying, instead of those big vials being used, they're using the single-use vials now. So when we're looking at vaccines as as pharmacists, we need to take into consideration how you're storing them, the timing of those doses, the duration of protection, how long is it going to last, when are we going to need that booster, any adverse effects associated with it, contraindications and precautions, the number of vaccines that need to be administered, and always the VIS, that vaccine information sheet that is really required by law that we give them to them, whether they read it or not. We are required that if we gave them a vaccination, then they should receive that. So this is just going over how we administer, you know, most things are given IM versus sub-Q, oral, or intranasal. This slide here just kind of breaks this down. Your IM only, most vaccines are given intramuscular. some are subcutaneous, like your MMR, your MMRV, and so forth. You, some can be given either or, your PPSV 23 or your polio. The intranasal, we talked about the flu mist, and then by mouth, you have your typhoid, your and then your oral solutions for cholera, your rotavirus, so forth. So that's administration and storage. A grace period. So what does a grace period mean? It means the dose is administered up to 4 days before the minimum interval. So, grace period is the dose administered up to 4 days before the minimum interval. So say the patient was supposed to get it at what? Either, let's say 14, let's say it's 24. Make sense. Say at 24 days. Well, this is saying that they can have it at 20 days, 4 days before the minimum interval, if it's part of a primary series or a booster. You can't use a grace period to try to circumvent when you are to take an actual scheduled dose. It's just trying to give you, as I say, a grace period, that yeah, if you need to take it a few days earlier, maybe you're traveling or whatever and stuff, then it would be acceptable, yes, that you can get it done within this time period. The minimal interval, and that's what I was trying to recall before, or on a catch-up schedule, is mostly 28 days. That period that you have to wait between the shot is typically 28 days. The administration slightly earlier is unlikely to interfere with any antibody production. So they think by you having a grace period of 4 days that it's not going to interfere with anything, and so, and therefore, it's okay to do. So ACIP says that a grace period of 4 days, it applies to the same antigen live vaccine. It does not apply to different live vaccines. Your oral live vaccines do not have this restriction, and they do not have interval rules. Different live vaccines may have interference if the interval is less than 28 days. Grace period cannot be applied to sequential dosing of like your MMR or MMRV and your varicella. You can't try to circumvent a scheduled dose, okay? Or trying to get ahead of it. This is just in some instances where you can't, it is permitted for you to be able to take it a little bit earlier. If a dose is administered earlier than the grace period, it is considered a vaccine administration error. So if you're trying to circumvent when you're supposed to give that dose and you're trying to give it sooner or outside of that little window that's being allowed, then it's considered an error. And it has to be written up as a vaccine administration error and reported. So just know that it's available, but you have to look at what it is that you're giving, and if that window, that 4 day grace period, if it applies. So do not use the grace period to try to schedule a dose, try to circumvent, you know, what a normal dosing schedule would be. So this sheet, this little chart, tried to put this together, just kind of give you some idea. So it's saying that if there's two inactivated vaccines, there's no minimal interval. Now what did we say the minimal interval was?
28 days.
At least 28 days, right? So it's telling you if you're giving two inactivated vaccines, there's no minimal interval. You can give them at the same time. inactivated and live vaccines, there's no minimum in them. But if it's two live vaccines and it's not given at the same time, then you have to wait 28 days. Does this make sense? Your inactivated vaccines and antibodies, no minimum. But with your live vaccines and you're given some type of blood product, transfusion, whatever, you have to wait 2 weeks. A blood product given before a live one, you have to just look up the interval just because things change. CDC is updating things all the time. The live vaccine followed by a PPD skin test. What's a PPD? What is that? Skin test. What is it talking about? Tuberculosis. Okay. There is a 28-day interval. The PPD skin test followed by a live vaccine. You can administer the vaccine after the skin test has been read. And you know there's usually a period that you have to wait and you go back and have it read. Nothing on refrigeration and storage other than just to remind you, vaccines from the manufacturer come with instructions and you have to learn to read them with each vaccine that you get each year, okay? Because things change as to how they want it, how it should be stored, how it should be mixed, so forth. All of this change. So just because you did it one way, you know, last year or last season or whatever it is, you have to always read what the manufacturer's instructions and things are regards to administration and also storage, how to mix them and dilute them, reconstitute it. Okay, so just note that. Vaccination screening. Also, don't forget this. Whenever you are, giving vaccines to your patients, these are your typical screening questions to ask. Are you sick today? Do you have any allergies to medications and foods or vaccine components? You know, your long-term health, are you basically trying to determine if there are immunocompromised as to, you know, which type of product you should give them or not? If there's any chance of being pregnant or planning on getting pregnant, and if they've received any vaccinations within that last 4 weeks. Remember, we talk about that interval. So all of these things are playing into counseling or triaging your patient before you give them their vaccine. And I would be remiss if I didn't go over adverse effects. Vaccines, just like any other medication, you know, come with risk. Or there are some side effects or adverse effects to it. So of course, the most common that we see that we also want to be able to communicate to our patient or our customer is just about that local injection site, the erythema, the tenderness, pain, swelling, you know, all of those things. Again, too, we talked about autism, reminding them that that is false. Fear has led to vaccine avoidance because of it. Vaccine preventable illnesses began to reemerge because why? We have gotten laxed because we don't see them anymore or the outbreaks like we have before. And because of it, you know, we have just kind of gotten behind on making sure that we're up to date with our immunizations. So again, with reporting adverse reactions, it's not punitive, so it doesn't matter. For you yourself as a practitioner or your customers or patients, if they think that the vaccine created any type of adverse event, you report it. All they do is VAERS is collecting data. They're just collecting that information, and if they start seeing where the same information keeps coming in, then it takes, you know, okay, now maybe we need to kind of take a look because we keep getting the same information over. So that's why I say no matter how minute or small it is, they're tracking that information. So make sure that you are reporting or you are telling your patients that it's okay to report as well. So you can even call them, you can go online to report it. So there's different ways that you can